It's time to babble the fuck on. Live from the world-famous improv, it's Hollywood Babylon. With your hosts, Kevin Smith and Ralph Garman.
Always feel left out of that, man.
Yeah.
Smith.
Feels pretty good.
Yeah, doesn't it?
It is Friday night in Hollywood, ladies and gentlemen. So let's bow the fuck on. I'm Kevin Smith.
I'm Ralph Garman.
Hey!
Hello! Back in the U.S. of A.
It's been a minute, man. Last time we did the show, we were overseas.
Yeah, we were in Londinium.
Lovely to be here, man. I've been looking forward to this fucking all week, man. Love making funny and stuff. It's been a while since we've been up here. I've been buried in dark rooms finishing up Jay and Silent Bob reboot.
Woohoo!
And today, we just finished the trailer. The company that's doing it is called AV Squad. They're right over here in town and stuff.
Are they a trailer company? Is that
trailer
what they do?
Company? They do all post cut trailers and stuff. So trailer cutting is a fucking art form.
Yeah.
Like just because I am intimately familiar with every frame of that movie because I dreamed it, I shot it, I'm in most of the footage, and then I cut it. I was the only hands on it, so I know every inch of our movie. But I could not, with a gun to my head, sell you that movie in a trailer. I couldn't distill it down to 2.5 minutes.
No, because it took you an hour and a half to tell the story. How do you tell it?
Exactly.
How do you tell it in 3 minutes?
And then they're like, can you tell it in 2.5? I'm like, fuck no.
If I could have done that, I would have made a 2.5 minute movie.
Would have been a YouTube clip.
That's
shit.
Right.
So you find people who are so much better at it than you, and we found some cats, including this cat, Bradley, who... If you look on my Instagram, months ago, I think it was like around Halloween, I go to Veggie Grill all the time.
Right.
And so I walked into Veggie Grill, and there was two dudes dressed like Jay and Silent Bob. And I was like, holy fuck, man. Like, fucking get these reprobates out of here and shit. And
you think you were having a stroke, maybe, when you
yeah.
walked in?
I was like, second heart attack.
I'm seeing my whole life flash in front of my eyes.
And it's just them, you know. So, we took a picture. I was like, oh, my God, we got to take a picture. I put it up on my Instagram. Like, fucking, this is over a year or two, maybe a year and a half later or something like that. I go into AV Squad because I'd seen a pass of the trailer, and I was like, let me go in and just give notes rather than writing a bunch of notes. I could just sit there and be like, try this, do this, blah, blah, blah. So I go in, and the dude running the deck was the dude who was dressed like Jay in the photo.
No way.
And I was like, they gave the movie to the right fucking guy, man. And he cut a fantastic fucking trailer. I love it. I like it more than the movie. It's way shorter. and it conveys everything. It's very exciting because I was, for the longest time, you know, as the storyteller, you're always in doubt as you head to marketing. Like, will they be able to tell this story in a trailer? And they really fucking nailed it. So I spent this afternoon doing that. Before that, I was out in Marina Del Rey because Comic-Con's on its way.
Yes, it is.
And every year at Comic-Con for the last 3 years, this will be the fourth year, they park me up on the IMD boat where I interview people for IMDb all throughout the con. So in advance of that, we always shoot a few clips, like here's things to look out for at the con. I interviewed a few people. Two of the people I interviewed were the Russo brothers.
No way.
Yes. The people who brought us, you know, Infinity War, Endgame, the very talented brothers, who essentially two of my favorite storytellers on the planet.
Wow.
So we were there to do a very quick, interview and set up something that's happening down in San Diego. Sounds very cool. It's like this cosplay event that they're doing. And it's part of this larger campaign to thank fans for Avengers Endgame. So they're pretty much there to like set that up. I was gonna ask him a few questions about Endgame, all pretty above boards. And I think people had like vetted the material in advance with their people, like with Disney, going like, oh, Kevin's gonna say this. And they're like, well, do you know exactly what he's gonna say? And they're like, no, it's fucking Kevin Smith. But like, at the end of the day, like he loves this shit. So you don't have to worry, he ain't gonna play and gotcha. He fucking, you know, he's a big fan. So we stand up to do the interview and stuff. And I had met Anthony Russo at a screening they had of Sci-Fi's Deadly Class that I was hosting, and they were exec producers on it. So I hadn't met his brother. So the interview begins, and you know they're standing there to do a very quick, like, hey man, we're gonna go down to San Diego, and boy, we can't wait to thank all the fans and shit like that. And instantly, I go fucking so deep and so hard. I go like, I say, Joe, Anthony knows this because I saw him and I told him this, but I just want to tell you this as well. What you guys did was nothing short of amazing. And yes, we all know it's made lots of money and the storytelling is fantastic, but you got to understand, I'm part of the community. I don't make movies like you, good ones and shit, but I do make movies. I know how the sausage is made, man. Right. Like, I've seen behind the process, so when I step into every movie theater, you know, I can watch the movie and enjoy it, but generally I'm also like Neo, I can see the zeros and ones and shit like that. I said, but your movies, they're a fucking gift, dude. They give me back my fandom. I step into those movies never once do I sit there and be like, this is what I would have fucking done different. Yeah. Like, not at all.
I see how they use the green screen there. Yeah, you're not doing
anything. Yeah, or fucking like, I can't believe they put Iron Man in this too. Like, you know, I'm like, I sit there and I get lost. And I told them, like, it reminds me of being brought to the movies by my dad. Like, when I go into your movies, I kick back and I'm a kid, literally a kid, on that ride to the Middletown movies with my father. And then on the way home, we would talk about the movies. That's a precious gift, dude. That's as close to taking a sip out of, you know, the fucking the fountain of youth. Like, you, I know you entertain everybody else, but you're entertaining the storytellers as well. And I just want to thank you. And so, like, Anthony had, I'd done that to him, gone real deep and, like, fucking hugged him way too long and shit like that.
Yeah.
When I met him. So he could kind of see, oh, Kevin's doing the Kevin thing. But his brother was not ready for it. And like, fucking, I shifted gears easily. So he was like, Jesus Christ, thanks. I was like, anyway, what are you guys doing at Comic-Con? And he was like, we're doing, nobody's ever said anything like that to me before, you know? He was like, that really moved me.
Let me process that for a moment.
It was fucking sweet. There's a nice part of the job is when you, like, I love being a fan of shit, but like, being able to actually go and tell the person,
yeah,
like, fuck, what your shit did for me, blah, blah, blah. Like, that's everything. So, like, this morning I got up and I was like, man, we got to go to Marina Del Rey so far. But I was like, I'm going to get to go and just tell those guys thanks. I was like, look, I speak for myself, but I know I speak for all the fandom, people that I've met and shit, people I've read on the internet. Like, you guys didn't just make a fucking movie. Like, you fan service the death of it to the point where, like, I sat there and said, that's exactly not even what I would have done if I was in charge. That's better because my imagination isn't this fucking big.
Right.
So it was really nice, man. That was a wonderful morning / afternoon. Then I got to go cut the trailer and stuff like that. Then I went home and I was on such a roll. And so I was like, and my wife was there. She just got back from yoga. Nobody else was home. And I was like, oh my God, let's fuck. She was like, fuck no. And then the day
dropped
right
off
in the
cliff,
fucking
huh?
toilet. Yeah. So I went off and smoked weed and watched a movie and shit. Waited for the show. I was like, Ralph will love me more.
I'll fuck you, sure. I got nothing to do tonight.
Right?
Yeah.
It's early. Like, normally we do this at 10. Doing it at 8, we got plenty of fucking
plenty
time.
Plenty of fuck time after the show.
What have you been up to? What did you do today?
I almost killed a guy. That was good.
How? Really?
Yeah. Almost killed a man.
Like in a car?
No. Don't like keep with guessing?
with your bare hands?
No. It was a
With your mouth?
It was so fucked up. I make him see heaven with my mouth. I don't send him there.
Such a lofty promise. Good thing nobody can check on. You know what I'm saying? What happened?
It was fucked up. I was home, and my kid was at camp, and my wife was asleep, taking a nap. And I hear at the front door... And I'm like, what the fuck is that? And then they're banging the knocker. And it's like, let me in, fucker, let me in.
Oh, shit.
Yeah.
Well, I told you I was coming over.
Suddenly, I'm in a fucking Jordan Peele movie. I don't know whether to shit myself or run out the back door or grab my wife and use her as a human shield. And this guy is for real. And he's banging. kick it, screaming, "Let me in! Let me the fuck in!" And the dog's going nuts.
Can you see people?
No, because we have a solid door.
That's what I thought. It's pretty hardcore.
So I don't have a peephole, and I didn't want to go around to the side where the entrance of my home is kind of off to the side. So you'd have to look through a window to see who it was, and I'm thinking, I don't know if he's armed or something. Do I want to make myself a target by sticking my head? Yoo-hoo! Do I want to give him something to shoot at, you know? And so I said, "Who is that?"
He's like, "It's Kevin and Bean." "Come on back. We need you, buddy." "I don't know if you heard, but Bean's leaving. Please, Ralph, come back."
Yeah.
"If you don't, we brought our gun."
"It's Peter," the guy screams, and I don't know a Peter. I mean, I know a Peter, but I don't know proper noun Peter.
Right.
And so then he starts trying to use the handle.
He's jiggling the handle.
Jiggling the handle. And rocking the doors, and we have double doors at the front, so it's rocking pretty good. And this is the hard part to tell, because I am a guy who politically leans fairly liberal, and I believe that there is room in America for sensible gun control.
Oh my God, thank God you said gun control. I didn't know what was coming next. You're like, "I'm a guy that I'm pretty racist," and
I do not like, God, like Ralph, minorities. I just want to go on a limb and say I don't like minorities. No.
Wait, so what?
No, so here's the thing. The reason I use it as a precursor is because my father was a longtime and passionate gun collector, and gave me, when he sold off his collection, he gave me a few pieces of his collection.
You are
so I have a
gun
in my home. Yes.
Really?
Yes. And it's in a lockbox, and it's in a closet, and I don't go there, but it's that if Peter comes knocking at your door kind of emergency thing, you know?
Fuck yeah.
And so I dial 911.
Why? You're like, "I'm going to kill Peter. Make me not do it."
No, because I would like to not kill Peter. I would like the authorities to show up and handle Peter.
True.
But should Peter make his way into my home before they arrive, Peter's going to get a bullet facial. That's what Peter's going to get. So I go to the lockbox and I get the gun out while I'm on the phone with 911, and they're asking those ridiculous questions that 911 asks. "Someone's trying to break into my home. Do you know the man?"
"No." "He says he's Peter. I don't know any Peter." "Well, I know a Peter, but get over here quick."
It's not a bad house guest. There's a stranger trying to get into my home. So they're asking me the questions, and I am now at by the door with a loaded weapon on the phone with 911, and Peter is not giving up, not relenting.
Do you have a gun in one hand, phone in the other?
Yes.
How are you holding the gun? Like fucking, like John McClane style? Or like, you know, fucking.
No, I was
side.
More like James Bond. I just put it like
yeah!
across my chest. Like Sean Connery.
"Why, hello, Peter."
Oh, that would scare the fuck out of me, man. If I busted in your door and you're just standing there like James Bond.
"So tell me, Peter, is whatever's in this home worth your life?"
No, I got the gun, yeah, like this. And
you're holding it up in the air?
Yeah.
I don't know. I've never held a gun.
Yeah. You really? Never have? I got to take you shooting sometime.
I mean, have I in the movies? Like, I've held a fake gun, but not, like, I've never held a real gun.
So they're saying, "Okay, there's authorities are on their way, sir. Stay on the phone with me, sir. Is there anyone else in the house?" I said, "Yes, my wife. She's in the bedroom. Is she sleeping?" I was like, "Well, not now, no." Peter's banging on the door, and the dog's going nuts.
What time was this?
It's midday. That's what was even weirder to me. So I'm thinking home invasion,
yeah,
you know? They're waiting for me to open the door or crack the door or something. They're going to kick it in, and then it's game over.
Oh, yeah.
So I hear a helicopter overhead. And eventually, two squad cars pull up, lights going, and I hear from the woman, "Is he still there?" And I said, "I don't know. I told you I really can't see him through the door, but I don't hear him banging anymore." And they said, "Well, we had a report there's a man walking away from your house. Do you think that's him?" And I said, "Probably."
Yeah. Sounds like Peter.
That Peter. And so They capture Peter in the street in front of my house.
Are you fucking kidding me?
No. And I go outside. They said, can you go meet with the officers? And I said, yes. She said, okay, we're going to disconnect then because the police are there and they'll handle it from here. Go out there. They have a man in custody. Can you go out and talk to the police officers?
I thought you were going to go out there to be like, fuck you, Peter! They got you!
Well, he's standing there next to the cops. So I put
justice!
Attica! Attica! So I put the gun away before I go out to talk to the police.
Smart call.
Because I watch the news. And I go out there, and when I'm out there, I see my next door neighbor, Mike, standing there with them, and he is ashen, white-faced. Peter is his friend. And Peter, an acquaintance, got the addresses screwed up and thought he was fucking around with Mike by fucking pounding on the door and being an asshole to his friend.
Oh, shit.
Peter had the wrong address.
For that little joke, Peter almost got his fucking face shot off.
That's what I'm thinking.
Wow.
Is that had the door been unlocked or ajar, or Peter had managed to pound hard enough for it to bust open, Peter would be in a fucking world of hurt right now.
Yeah, man.
And then I'd be the guy who shot my neighbor's friend. That's a lose-lose right there. More for Peter than for me, don't get me wrong. I'd be embarrassed. He'd be dead. But I was so rattled after the fact by the whole experience, but also by the fact that, by that fact, if he had somehow managed to work his way into the house, I don't think I would have stopped and asked him any questions.
That'd be like, you sure you're at the right house?
Get out your phone. Check Google Maps. Make sure you're at the right place. I don't think I'd go through any of that. I probably would have been one of those knee-jerk assholes who just pulls the trigger. It was terrifying.
Why does that make you an asshole? Somebody bursts into your house.
Because it was a big misunderstanding.
Not your fucking problem.
That's true.
Very much Peter's fucking problem. Sounds like Mike has a little blame as well.
Peter was screaming, I'm so sorry, from across the street. From
beyond
like,
the fuck cops. You, go to jail! My wife was sleeping at noon! Let me ask you this, man.
Yeah.
The heart's all pumping and shit like
oh,
that?
Oh, you have no idea. I was... I felt like Bill Bixby in The Incredible Hulk, you know? Where he... Ah! The rage and the blood is pulsing and the vein... I got one of those Julia Roberts veins on my forehead popping up. And I was enraged. But at the same time, my wife said, you were so fucking cool. You were like, you got the thing out of the closet, you were on the phone, you're handling the book, you checked the thing to make sure there was a cartridge in the chamber and everything.
Did you know how to do all that
oh,
shit?
Yeah. Like I said, my dad was a gun collector his whole life, and so he would take me out to the shooting range and stuff.
I gotta tell you, it's kind of sexy that you know all that shit.
But it was literally like in the movies. I did the chamber on the 45. And
what do you
I
mean
was,
you did the chamber? What, you got a...
Well,
like,
you got a clip. You got a clip in a semi-automatic weapon like a 45, right?
It wasn't
a piece of metal
gun?
That holds the bullets.
I've seen that part in the movie.
Right, so that goes up inside the handle.
Yeah.
And in order to engage it, in order to get a bullet into the chamber to fire it, you have to pull back that slide mechanism, and that loads a bullet into the chamber.
One into the chamber.
Pulls the hammer back, and then you're ready to shoot after that.
Do you have to
So I leave it, it with a bullet out of the chamber when it's in the box. So it can't
Smart.
Accidentally go off, or even if someone gets in there, there's no accidents waiting to happen. So when you're ready to use it, you got to lock and load, as they say.
Once you do this, you don't have to do that with every shot.
No, then you're good to go.
If you emptied the
Bad
clip...
Bad news for Peter, I'm good to go at that point. Yeah.
If you emptied the clip, could you do shit like in action movies where you're like, ch-ch, and one flies up, and you're... Fuck you, Peter!
I don't think I'd be doing this. Unless I wanted Peter to die of laughter.
Did your wife, like, was she a little turned on by it? Not by, like, the fucking incident, but the fact that you were like, I've got this. Like,
she
went
said,
Batman.
She goes, she was like, that was pretty impressive how you were, like, pretty calm in spite of your fear and managed to get everything going and you had the cops in one hand and you had your gun in the other hand and you were waiting by the door for Peter to break in. She goes, that was pretty impressive that you handled the situation as quickly and as readily as you did. And I was like, boop.
Yeah.
And she went, boop. And she went back to bed, and I and I burst a blood vessel in my brain. So that was my afternoon. That's what I did today.
Fucking spooky, man.
Well, so I need this. What I'm saying is I need this.
Down it. How's that feel?
Thank you so much.
That tastes like justice.
So much better. I'm going to go fucking find Peter now. Now I'm fucking pissed. Yeah, so that was my day. So,
what do you think the protocol on that sort of thing? Pete should send a basket, right?
At the very least, Pete should send a basket. Yeah. He should fondle my basket is what he should do.
It'd be amazing if he's listened to the podcast and then heard that you almost got fucking killed and shit.
Yeah. Good. Good for Pete.
He joins up and becomes a Garmy member. Well, that's exciting, man. Look at you.
Yeah.
You lived a million lives in
action
one day.
Action hero. How about me?
Your story beats mine. Give it up for Ralph. He lived real life.
All right, let's get things going. Our first show back in the USA in a while. By the way, I want to thank, is this from you, Aaron? Aaron gave me this. Thank you so much for the present. I appreciate that. I've heard a lot about Jack Daniels. I've never really had any, but I'm looking forward to trying it.
Oh, and I just got something as well.
Oh, you did too. Is that a pocket vibrator?
For the mind. Looks like it's a pre-roll joint. I'm going to smoke this later on. Thank you so
Speaking
much.
Speaking of pre-rolls, I guess we should mention that, Kevin, you brought some goodies to
I
give
out. Yeah. I did. Earlier this week, yesterday, I was online, and I was like, man, I don't know what to do with my empty single tubes. When you get a joint, it comes in a ridiculous amount of packaging. For those of you out there who don't follow this sort of thing, once you open the package, inside there's a tube, and it's got a joint in it. Once you use the joint, tube is just plastic, goes right into recycling and shit.
Right.
So I was trying to like give them back to the dispensary herbarium because I smoked these caviar joints, which were fucking amazing. And but there's so many tubes, I used to bring them back in, but they're like, it's against the law for us to use them again because it's unsanitary. I was like, what am I supposed to do with them? They're like, just recycle them, throw them out. So I was like, man. And then I realized, oh shit, I could sign them all and just give them out, and I have so many and stuff. So I've signed, I had 65 in my house.
From today, right?
From this week.
Yeah.
And so I signed them all. And then I signed a bunch of cards as well, Jay and Silent Bob reboot cards to make up. So everybody walks away with something signed today. And some people will be walking away with tube tubes.
So on your way out, make your way by the merch table out on the patio there and pick yourself up a free Kevin Smith autograph thingy.
I saw somebody on Twitter was like, Kevin's recycling in his own way.
Yes, he is. All right, let's kick the show off the way we usually do by talking to you kind folks who came out to see us tonight. People have come particularly long distances or celebrating special occasions with us tonight. We call this segment the Shoutouts.
It's a shout-out with Kevin and Ralph, so get your cock out. Yeah, get your cock out.
You still got it, kid.
That's what I do with a Peter.
If Peter broke into your home, yeah, that's the way you would disarm him.
He wouldn't be shot in the face. I'd be shot in the face.
Gerald Cromwell.
That is the way I would treat a home invader.
Is it?
Hands down, dude. I'd fight, either it'd be like, please, no, my God. I'd go like Alan Rickman in Die Hard when he was in the building. Like, oh, God. Or I'd be like, let me suck your dick. Let's get this over with real fast. I'll tell you where everything is after I'm done. I don't want no violence. Love, man.
All right. Gerald Cromwell.
Hey!
Holy shit.
Yay!
He fell off the top. How are you, Cromwell? Well done.
Gerald's here with his wife, Amber, tonight. My wife, Amber, and I are big fans of the show. We've been listening to the podcast since day one. We're coming up on 10 years, I think.
What do you mean you think? You don't know that sort of thing?
Actually, no. I think we're coming up on nine years. Yeah.
Still fucking huge.
Yeah. This will be our first time watching it live. Well, welcome. Thanks for coming out tonight.
Thanks,
tonight,
Tanner.
Amber and I are celebrating our 11th wedding anniversary.
Wow. Well done, kids.
We first met at a movie theater where we both worked. I worked in concessions and projection booth, and she worked as a box office attendant.
They don't let those jobs cross over? It's like, you've got to be there, you've got to be there. So you guys were always like, you weren't in the same department. You were always just missing each other. It's like Lady Hawk. Did you ever see that?
Yeah. That's an interesting pull.
Dick Donner classic.
Yeah. I worked concessions in a box. We first hooked up when I was in film school and my lead actress bailed on me. Amber, with no acting... Film school got a laugh? My lead actress bailed on me. Amber, with no acting experience, offered to fill the role. After a long day of shooting, Amber made the first move, and the rest is history.
Did you just take the job so you can suck his dick? That's the problem with Hollywood.
Yeah, exactly. Casting couch. We've been together for almost 14 years. She's my best friend, the love of my life, and an awesome mother to our two daughters.
Oh, my God. That's so awesome. I feel dirty for talking about dick sucking.
You should.
You got kids.
To celebrate, I was hoping Ralph could sing our wedding song, Michael Jackson's The Lady in My Life, as my favorite action hero, Arnold Schwarzenegger. Thanks again for the laughs, movies, and podcasts. Cheers, Gerald Cromwell. You know, I don't know the Michael Jackson song, Lady in My Life, so I went online to listen to it, and I listened to it, and I said, no, I'm not going to sing that. It's lovely. It's a very sweet song, but it's really, really slow and a little dull. And it's probably good for dancing to at a wedding, but not so good in a podcast situation. So to make up for it, I will sing Michael Jackson as Arnold Schwarzenegger, but it's going to be Billie Jean, okay? So I'm close. I got the right artist anyway. Josh, can I get a little music, please?
Billie Jean is not my lover, no. She's just a girl who said that I am the one, yeah. And the kid is not my son. Well, actually it is, because I fucked my maid. She said, I am the one. And I said, no, the kid is not my son, but it is, actually.
There we go. That's happy anniversary, you crazy kids.
How many kids?
Two.
Two. What are they? Couple girls. Yeah. Right the fuck on, man.
That's the way to go. Girls, right?
You yeah, with me? I got one as well.
I got one, too.
11 fucking years. What's the weirdest thing that's happened over the course of 11 years?
Has Peter ever come to your house? I don't recommend it. You put him on the spot. I feel bad for these kids now.
I do.
Yeah.
I'm sure it was all nothing weird and it was all good.
Brett,
you're going to be driving home. It's going to be a real existential crisis. What was the weirdest thing that ever happened to us?
Our lives are so boring. Fuck.
I mean, we totally choked. Like... We gotta do some shit. They're gonna start swinging, sucking dick on the side. Come back next
life.
Year. They're like, I hope they pick us again.
Walk in with needles hanging out of their arms. We're ruining their lives by your question.
Sorry, man.
Brett from Australia. Hey, Brett, how are you? Welcome.
Right there, man. What's up?
My name is Brett. I've come all the way from Australia to babble the fuck on. I've been a fan since 2011 and been working a crappy factory job for years just so I could save up and come to the States to complete my bucket list items. Wow. Good for you, sir.
Well done. Where in Australia? In Melbourne.
Right on.
Melbourne.
I've
been a fan of Kev's for years. Oh, by the way, I'm now 37. See what he did there?
Oh, it's your magic year.
In a row. And I'm also a fan of The Ralph Report. Listening to that podcast makes my job better and a happier place. Thank you, sir, for subscribing to The Ralph Report. I thank you, then. I'd love to complete one huge bucket list item and get a photo with both of you. Well, fuck, if you subscribe to The Ralph Report, hell yeah, I'll bring you up here.
Get on
come
up
on.
Here, Australia.
Come on up here, Brett. Let's get a picture. You're going to take it yourself with that giant tablet you have. But you know what? The good thing is, it doesn't fit inside one of those little fucking Ziploc bags, does it? So he's very smart. He's got a picture. There we go. Brett, come on up here. I've had my portrait painted in less time than it takes to take this picture. Sit there. You'll be the co-host for the day, Brett. There you go. Here we go. There you go, Brett. One bucket list item is off the list. Thank you for coming all this way from Australia.
From fucking Melbourne. What's the factory job?
Pillows.
Pillows? He works
it
in a pillow factory.
It sounds so hard and letter. I work hard at a neat old factory
ching,
and shit.
Ching, ching. Instead it's fluff, 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 fluff. It's not that hard.
What is it?
Furniture and bedding.
But you're in the pillow department?
Of the furniture and
you're
stuff.
You're putting furniture together.
You're not in the pillow department.
Yeah. Funny, yet pillows was the first thing you thought of when you thought of your job. I know,
bedding and bedding.
I know what he's doing on his break. He's fucking those pillows. That's what he's doing.
Don't get him fucking fired, man. I'm like, Greg, come in here. Do you fuck the pillows?
Do you get to walk away with free pillows at least?
Half price
pillows? Not fucking bad.
Not
we
a bad
go to
deal.
Australia,
right? There's a fortune to be made in the pillow.
Yeah, some pillow half business. Price pillows. Pillows are fucking expensive. I buy at least a pillow a month, I feel like, because I travel a lot, flying a lot.
Yes.
And sometimes I bring a pillow from home because it's best to travel.
I've seen you with your travel pillow. Yes.
Sometimes I forget when I'm on the road, I buy a pillow and shit. So then I wind up bringing lots of pillows home. And if you go to our bed, no shit, 14 fucking pillows are all over the bed. And not in that kind of like, oh, it's
decorative
like
way.
Bed and beyond. Yeah, it's just like, that's the fucking pillow
pillows.
Mount. And my wife's like, I'm going to leave it on there as a constant reminder, you're a fucking idiot. And I'm like, I don't care. I got all the pillows.
Greg and Tom Chapman, are you guys here tonight? Hey there, guys. How are you? My name is Greg Chapman. My dad, Tom Chapman, and I will be attending the Babylon. We've traveled from upstate South Carolina.
Oh, shit. That's almost as far as Australia.
Yeah. Is upstate the name of a town?
Spartanburg.
Spartanburg? Okay. It was capitalized here, and I thought maybe there was literally a town called upstate South Carolina. We're out here visiting my dad's sister, who I have never met, and he has not seen in over 30 years.
Holy wow. Shit, are you kidding me? That's like a fucking TV movie. How's it been?
California. Yeah?
Yeah,
I moved to
South Carolina. Fucking A, man. Wait, have you seen her yet?
Yeah, yesterday.
How was it?
Yesterday, we went to Huntington Beach and Venice Beach.
Fucking A. I've never been to either of those places. What's it like? Seriously, I've been out here 17 years. Huntington Beach, where's that?
Down Orange County way.
Is it?
Down south.
That's too far from where I live. Yeah. Easily 45 minutes or something like that. How'd you like it out here? It's nice, right? It's kind of like South Carolina.
Tom apparently grew up in Whittier, California.
That's fucking Whittier, California, man. So you're from out here. You're like, fuck you. I'm a local. Isn't that, that's where Nixon's from too, Whittier, right?
That's where his library is too, I think.
Is it? The presidential library is in Whittier?
No, no. Oh, Yorba Linda. Not Whittier at all.
Somebody whipped out their Whittier dick and it was huge.
Yes.
Somebody whipped out their Whittier dick and it was like...
Yeah, right. Our lives have been a roller coaster the past few years, writes Greg. My dad almost lost his life a few times back since he had his colon removed a few years back.
Oh, my God, I'm so sorry.
Sorry about that. As recent as this past December... We didn't know if he was going to make it to 2019, but he recently received his disability settlement and wanted to take us on a father and son California trip he'd been talking about since I was a kid.
Come on, that's fucking beautiful.
And here we are. I'm beyond excited to be here to be ever grateful if Ralph could let my dad know what he's in store for tonight in the voice of Al Pacino. Thank you so much. Thanks for all the free funny and being there when we were both cursing the darkness. How cool is that? Very
you
poetic.
You fucking rock, Greg, man. You're living life right. And for that reward, you're going to get a bad impression. Here it goes. I'm sorry. Did I say bad? I meant bad like good in the 80s and shit. It's going to be bad, man. Watch this.
Ooh-ah. Oh, the Chapman boys are in fucking California. Who would have fucking thought it? All the way back home to fucking Whittier and all the way from upstate South Carolina. Poor Tom here, no colon. Taken out. Now he's got a semicolon.
You grab for whatever you can think of in these situations.
You boys are in for a good time tonight. Because I heard a guy almost fucking killed a guy. This is a good show. Boom, Peter. Fuck you.
Thank you, guys. Thanks for coming out tonight. Dan and Sol, are you guys here?
Hey.
Hey, kids. My name is Dan, longtime listener, first-time hollerer. That was good. Here tonight with my good friend Sol, as you read this, there's a wonderful man named Steve who works at the Improv, supplying you and your loyal fans with copious amounts of alcohol. Is he a waiter here?
Yeah.
Where's Steve? Is Steve here? Is he on the floor?
Yeah.
Where? Raise your hand, Steve. He's in the back. All right. where he belongs, fucking Steve. I don't know.
Where he belongs.
Steve has been an amazing and loyal friend for years, and whenever I've needed a pick-me-up, he's able to get me into a show at the Improv so I can laugh my ass off.
Aww.
Good for Steve.
Fucking A.
So I was hoping you could pay tribute to Steve tonight, and perhaps Adam West's Batman and Bane could sing him, show him how much I love him by singing him A Whole New World from Disney's Aladdin. Interesting. Thanks for all the free funny. P.S. If you pronounce my last name correctly, I'll buy you a drink. Oh, man, this is a challenge worth picking
Spell
up
it
right
first.
Here. M-I-L-A-M. M-I-L-A-M. It's got to be a trick to it, or else he wouldn't
Let's
have
play it like
that.
Family Feud. We got to confer before we get
okay.
one answer.
All right, okay.
Malam. No, you got to say it out loud. Don't you ever watch fucking Family
yeah,
Feud?
But they
talk to each other.
Quietly so the other team can't
no,
hear.
Oh, that's bullshit. They go blah, 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 and then they go, okay, and then they say
okay.
That. All right, so here. That's fucking Jeopardy. Here we go. Ready?
I don't think it's Milan. That seems way
they
too
tell
easy.
Us, get ready
he wouldn't
to
have
steal.
Said. He wouldn't have challenged me if it was a normal way to say it.
Fuck you. You always do this. That's what they do on Family yeah. Feud. But
oh
you
my
can't
God,
hear
you're
it.
Such a pain in the ass. I'm thinking Milam.
I'm thinking the way he's saying, "I'll buy you a drink." It must be difficult. So Milam. I'm thinking
Milam.
Milam.
I think it's Milam or Milam. Milam or Milam.
My,
you want to go
could
with
be,
my lamb?
It could be both. My lamb.
Oh, my lamb.
Yeah, oh, what
that
if it
sounds like a heartburn medicine. Try new my lamb.
Or it sounds like a very possessive farmer. Dan, my lamb.
My lamb. Dan, my lamb. What are we going with? What's our consensus?
I go my lamb.
My lamb.
That's me.
Okay, here we go.
All right, here we go.
Dan, is it my lamb?
It's my lamb.
Ooh. So close. So close. You cost me a drink.
I was on a game show recently. I did an episode of Match Game, and it was my second Match Game I've ever done.
How fun.
So I can't tell you the results because they're real fucking serious about this.
There's laws and shit.
But I can tell you the story of another game show I was on, which was Pyramid, and that's already aired.
Right.
And it was one of those episodes where, like, the person won. And then they won again, so they were going for, like, the big fucking prize.
Right.
And I was the one with my back to the thing. And
so
like,
you were in the winner's circle?
Yeah, I made it all the way and shit like that. And we got to, there was, like, what is it, 5 clues in the pyramid?
Right.
We got to 4, and we were getting to the last fucking clue.
No.
And this lady was going to win, like, what is the top prize?
$200,000?
I think it's $200,000.
Is it 200?
For if they do it, like, the bonus or whatever, fuck. And she said, it's the clue was...
So she's giving the clues to you. She's reading the board and giving them to you.
Yeah. Okay. And the clue was, like, had the word tough in it. And she goes, okay, so it's rough. And they go, eh. And they blanked it.
Oh, because it's a form of the word?
And they said, well, the guy came over, it was Michael Strand. He goes, ooh, the judges just said that you can't, you gave too close to the clue, you know, in too close to the answer in your clue. So, oh, I'm sorry, it's not going to work out.
That's
and they'll be like,
up.
We'll be right back for the commercial break. So, you know, the girl was looking at me, and I was looking at her, and I was like, oh, no, that's so, oh, my God. But, like, you know, I didn't really have anything to apologize for. I didn't fuck up or anything.
Right.
But I felt really bad and shit. And, you know, because $200,000 is a fucking ton of cash. So she goes, like, rough and tough aren't the same thing. And I was like, I don't think so.
And that's a phrase that's part of, you know, that's a legit clue.
Totally. And I said, I don't think so. And she goes, I should say something, right? And I was like, fuck yeah, $200,000.
You fucking instigator.
That's
Kevin
a lot
Smith,
of
union,
money.
Union, the Norma Rae of game shows all of a sudden.
So she goes over to confer, like not confer, like they were wrapping up the show. And she went over to be like, excuse me, and I could see it from a distance, and talk to them. About like, I don't think you guys are right about that. And I saw them bring the judge out and stuff like that. And they conferred for like a good 10 minutes and finally she came back to sit down because they had to reshoot the ending or something. So I was like, oh my God, they're gonna let her fucking win. So she sat down and was like, you did it. And she goes, I didn't.
Oh no.
And she didn't win. It was so heartbreaking.
That man. Sucks to and lose he, on a technicality.
And the technicality was so close. And right before the game began, like I met the judges. And I was like, oh my God, I always thought they made you guys up. You're real? And they're like, oh no, it's a real job. And I almost felt like they did it to prove a point to me. They're like, we told you. judges.
We control lives over here.
Very sad,
fucked
though.
Up. All right, so you want to sing A Whole New World from Disney's Aladdin for Steve?
I do.
All right.
And I'm doing it as Bane.
This is a segment we haven't done in a while. We used to do it on the reg. It's called Dynamic Duets.
Get ready to get wet with Bane and Adam West in
Dynamic Duets.
That's right. Adam West is Batman, Bane, of course, and we're going to sing A Whole New World. Okay, hit it there, Josh.
Beauty and the Beast.
I can show you the world. Shining, shimmering, splendid. Tell me, princess, now when did you last let your heart decide?
I could open your eyes. Take you wonder by wonder. Over, sideways, and under. On a magic carpet ride.
A whole new world.
Or at least fairly new.
A new fantastic point of view. No one to tell us no. Or where to go. Or say we're only dreaming.
A whole new world. A dazzling place I never knew. But when I'm way up here, it's crystal clear that now I'm in a whole new world with you. What a lovely singing voice.
All right, there you go. Thank you, Steve, for bringing everyone drinks and getting that guy into free shows, which means I'm guessing he didn't pay for this one. So fuck you, Steve, I guess is what I meant to say. We also get emails from all around the world. Josh?
Ain't no drag.
Garmin's got an email bag.
Featuring Kevin's reactions.
That's right. You were just talking about Avengers Endgame and the Russo brothers. Well, we got this. From time to time, we get fan art that's sent to us. And this came from Jan Peter from the Czech Republic. We have a listener in the Czech Republic.
Just one?
I'm pretty sure we're against the law in the Czech Republic. I'm not sure. But he said, in honor of Avengers Endgame breaking every record possible and you guys being huge geeks and all, I started up my Photoshop and made you this Avengers Endgame Babylon mashup piece filled with my favorite voices that the both of you do. I hope you like it. Jan did amazing work with this poster. It's a movie poster. It's called Babylon Endgame. I want you to take a look at it. But it's all the voices that we do on the show.
Oh, my God.
Kevin is Kermit and Bane and Batman and Rocky and the Germans are there. And everybody's on that poster. It's so awesome.
That's a pretty fantastic piece of work,
man. I know. I think we need to make those. That's pretty awesome.
Am I Bieber in the middle?
Yeah, you're Justin Bieber there. Throwing up the deuces, yo.
I didn't know I was pulling it off,
yeah.
Apparently enough. Yeah. Right on. That's awesome.
We love it on the show when people send in lyrics to popular songs that they misunderstood for their entire lives until recently. It's great when people admit they're idiots. And this week, it's Garrett Covey of Diamond Bar, California. He could never understand why listening to this very popular classic rock song, how radio stations could get away with using the word asshole so blatantly on the air. He said, in the lyrics, they talk about millions of people, comma, living assholes. And he couldn't understand how you could call that many people living assholes on the radio and they didn't bleep it or anything.
I didn't even know it was a curse. You're a living asshole.
Literally a living asshole. Turns out the song that he was listening to was Ozzy Osbourne's classic Crazy Train. Let's play the section of the song that Garrett misunderstood each time.
How it goes. Oh. Millions of people
living assholes.
Makes it a kind of metal, more metal song, you know?
He thought millions of people living as foes was actually living assholes.
I mean, he's better than me. I didn't know what it is. So at that point of the song, I was always like, millions of people None of me know.
Can we hear that again, Josh?
Crazy, but that's how it goes. Millions of people living as foes.
Living assholes.
I like his version better.
Yeah. We'll let it stand, Garrett. No worries. We also love it when people from around the world find little places where they live, whether it's a town or a village or a street that's got a fucked up name, and they send it in to us via photograph, and we call this segment, Your Town's Got a Fucked Up Name.
Your town's got a fucked up, your town's got a fucked up, your town's got a fucked up name.
Danny from Minnesota sent this one in. He said, this is, am I having a stroke or the lights keep dimming?
Peter's back.
Yes. Peter's running the board. If the place goes dark, everybody duck, because it means Peter's coming after me. Danny from Minnesota writes, this is an actual recreational body of water in nearby Stearns County, Minnesota. Now, I don't care how hot it gets in Minnesota this year. If I'm near here, I am not swimming in this body of water. Here's the one he took a picture of. It is Spunk Creek. I don't want to go swimming in Spunk Creek.
That could be very refreshing. You don't know.
I don't believe so. I see it as being warm and sticky.
You could go swimming in Spunk Creek, but don't swallow.
Well, it's just rude not to swallow.
Oh, well.
I also am often confused, perplexed, flummoxed by the people in the East. In Japan there. It's no secret that I'm confused by the way they live their lives. So every week I ask the respectful question, what the fuck, Japan?
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 What the fuck, Japan comes from Michael Brooks in Mount Rainier, Maryland.
There's a Mount Rainier in Maryland as well as Washington?
Apparently there is.
Wow.
MD, that's Maryland, right?
Yeah. Unless he's like Mount Rainier Doctor.
Dr. Mount Rainier. Coming this fall on CBS.
Have you been hurt on the mountain? He'll come get you. Dr. Mount Rainier. Michael Brooks.
I love that. That may be my favorite joke of the evening.
Thank you.
He sent me this video. This is an actual real deal. Recently just happened in Japan. There is a zoo called the Tobe Zoo there in Japan, and they run periodically escape drills at the zoo to make sure that no one gets hurt if a wild animal gets out of its enclosure and runs rampant through the crowd there at the zoo.
Oh.
So periodically, to test their staff and to train them, they will run an escape drill. I cannot believe this is the most efficient way to do it, however. It is one of the zookeepers, in this case, dresses up as a lion in a lion costume and runs around the zoo. And then the other zookeepers have to go into action and see if they can corral him before the fake lion in the mascot costume mauls visitors. I'm not quite sure what's happening here. And it cannot replicate, by the way, what an actual fucking lion would do if it got out of its cage. I promise you this. Here's the video. I want you to watch it in its entirety of the Tokyo Zoo's lion drill.
Oh.
All right, he's roaming around, he's dangerous. Oh, look at him, he's a crazy lion. Everyone, oh, put up the nets. There's a lion loose. How are we gonna stop him? Oh, I'll go this way then. Said the fierce, slow-moving lion, and
oh shit!
I will barely shove you. Uh-oh! They put out the big guns. They have a gun with tranquilizer darts. They're gonna put that lion to sleep if they can get through the velour. These lions are like, what the fuck? Oh, they got him, and the dangerous lion has been subdued. Well, you better poke him and make sure. And they're like, what? Really? That is a weak-ass lion. And they net him up, and then they put him in the back of the van.
Oh, my God.
What the fuck, Japan?
It's awesome. It's almost as if they do it for the real lions and be like, this is what'll happen to you.
That can't be the best way to test the crew to see if they can handle a lion emergency.
The real lions are like, this embarrasses us both.
We would have killed you all by now. That's what the lions are saying. We would be licking your blood off of our lips.
Maybe
right
it
now.
Wasn't a drill. Maybe just in Japan they hunt mascots.
This is not the first time it's happened in Japan, by the way. They do it all the time. All the zoos do the same drill. We've had, in the past, chimpanzee drills.
Oh, he's not as cute.
There's been a leopard drill at one of the zoos.
That's adorable.
A leopard?
Who wants to catch that except to hug him?
An orangutan was loose in one zoo?
Fairly realistic.
This looks dangerous. This zebra, how do you catch him?
Cut him in half. Watch him run around.
He keeps running, though. We've cut him in half, and he keeps running. And then, of course, even tigers.
Oh, shit.
They killed Tigger.
They caught Tigger.
They killed Tigger. Children were mortified.
Bottoms may be made of rubber, but fucking not the head, man.
Yeah. Headshot takes Tigger right out. What the fuck, Japan? All right. And lastly, we love it when you guys send in photos of stuff that's meant for kids. They're supposed to be able to enjoy, but when you look at them, you go, these are inappropriate toys.
Not appropriate for girls, not appropriate for boys. What the fuck is that? Inappropriate toys.
This first one comes from Australia. Brent Kerr in Australia sent this in.
Australia, man.
One of your countrymen, sir.
You know this guy? What's his name?
Brent Kerr. Brent Kerr?
You know Brent at all?
You know Brent? No.
You don't work at the pillow factory?
He's in comforters. That's a whole other section.
Totally. Yeah. Plush comforter, son of a bitch. I'm down here putting the fucking furniture together. He's sewing together fucking duvet covers, piece of shit. All I want to do is go see Ralph and fucking Kevin in America.
I can't.
Ooh, what's this? Another iced tea?
Thank you. Look at you. You're backed up.
Thank you. With a smaller glass. Yeah, totally.
That was Steve. Apparently
they felt like I've gotten too much. Like, give him a smaller glass.
Yeah.
That was Steve.
What happened?
That was Steve?
Yeah, that was Steve.
Holy shit, give it up for Steve, man.
Steve.
What is it?
Hi, table in the back. Thank you for the shot. I appreciate that. You're very kind.
What was that all about? Don't give him liquor.
No, then I'll be like that lion at the zoo. I'll just be going around doing this to people, knocking them over.
Be a good job. They didn't even ask that guy to emote much. He just like walked around and shit.
In case zombie lions ever attack the zoo, I think they're in good shape.
It would have been like, get on all fours at the least.
Right, or run faster. Be dangerous. Bad acting. Brent said in Australia, I think they do this in the States too. They've got that campaign, you're not yourself when you're hungry. The Snickers people do that, you know?
Oh, yeah.
The commercials, you're not yourself when you're hungry. It's like Betty White or something. Then they give him a Snickers and then he becomes the guy, right?
Right.
So in order to continue that advertising campaign, at least in Australia, I don't know if I've seen these in the States, they put different emotions on the Snickers bar to show what you might feel like before you eat it, like sleepy cranky or whatever. Brent says, given his recent legal battles, this may not be the best candy bar to feed children. I don't know why he says that, but...
oh, shit!
Yeah. You may not want your son sucking on a Spacey bar. Maybe you pull that one from the stands if you're Snickers. Another one from Australia, Tasmania. No, nothing? Yeah.
You vouch for this Tasmania bullshit?
Lyndon Holloway from Tasmania, Australia. Tasmania's like an island off of Australia, right?
Yeah.
Sectioned off. They keep him there because that devil's there. I had this on the TV while I was preparing breakfast for my 2-year-old. I had to double check to make sure I heard correctly. It's from a Nickelodeon show called Sunny Day, and I guess we know what that cheerleader's looking for. This is a clip from a show on Nickelodeon called Sunny Day, a little cartoon show for little girls. It's adorable. One little girl has a dog, and the dog is going into a dog show, and so one of her friends wants to be supportive, and she wants to show off her cheer, and even the characters in the cartoon are shocked by what she says.
I don't know what you've been told, but Doodle always goes for gold.
Hey, I like that, and I Daddy Doodle's cheer squad. Give me your D! Huh?
Give me a D!
Their reaction, huh?
What? You're a cartoon child. What do you want a dick for?
Seemed inappropriate.
Sunny day indeed.
Sounds like a porn name to begin with.
Yeah.
And lastly, Sam Halim from Hayward, California sent this in. He was shopping for something for his kid. He was looking for a water pistol. They have a battery-powered water pistols now, which are shoot pretty far and stuff. For the summer coming up, he was looking for one.
That's what you always want to do, mix water with electric.
Yes. And he found this on an online store called the Playful Bag Store. And this is a place that sells electric water pistols, but also interchangeable grips for the water pistol as well. And this was available, and he thought maybe this wasn't right for his son. I don't know. So
oh, shit!
Yeah. Can we go to the second one? It's easy to install, apparently. Just you get the grip in your hand, and then you just use that Allen wrench, and boom, you're good to go. You're letting your kid hold balls.
They put emotions on them. One of them says, Spacey.
I don't know if you want your kid holding something that's shooting fluid out of the front of it while he's holding the balls on the other end. It's just a.
But if you're gonna shoot it in slow-mo.
That's right. Work in progress. We also say goodbye to some people every week here on the show. People have been in show business who left us too soon, but left behind bodies of work that we'll enjoy for many years to come. They are our Tinseltown Stiffs.
And now another edition of
Tinseltown Stiffs.
They will be missed.
If you're around the late 80s, early 90s, then you knew this TV dad. Willie Tanner from ALF has passed away. Max Wright was his name.
Get out of here.
Yeah, Max Wright passed away this week on Wednesday at 75 years old. He had been battling cancer for years. He was diagnosed with lymphoma in 1995 and then went into remission, but apparently he came back in a big, bad way. But he was a very funny actor, very talented. He was Tony nominated on Broadway, big stage actor. Then got into television. I remember him from a show called Buffalo Bill
with Dabney Coleman.
He was great on that. He was great on ALF, too. As goofy as the premise was for ALF, he did an excellent job of grounding that situation.
Selling it, yeah.
He passed away in Hermosa Beach Wednesday at 75. I thought we'd send him off with a clip from an iconic episode of ALF. This is when ALF wants to go to a Halloween party that the Tanners are having. And so he tapes a zipper to his front so it looks like he's wearing a costume.
How that works.
And he shows up to hang out, and Max Wright's character, Willie, who's always desperately trying to keep the fact that they have an alien in the house away from prying eyes, is not too happy. Here's the late Max Wright.
Okay, mister, I want the truth, and I want it now.
All right. Your hair is thinning.
You got hold of our guest list, didn't you? You called those people and told them to wear costumes just so you could come.
You dragged me in here to tell me things I already know?
Talented guy. Passed away at 75.
Huge bucket of wind, man.
For a guy to be that real, talking to a puppet is always impressive.
Yeah.
And we lost a great character actor this week as well. His name was Billy Drago, 73 years old. You may not know the name, but I'm sure you know his work. He was in.
No!
Yeah.
Untouchables?
Frank Nitti from The Untouchables.
Fuck, man. Yeah. That's one of my favorite fucking villain moments in movie history. Where
that's
he's like,
the one we're going to show.
Your friend died like a pig. What? I said he died like a pig. He died like a stuck pig. Now
stuck
you think
Irish
about,
pig.
That's it. Stuck Irish pig. Now you think about that while I beat the rap.
Yeah.
And they pit. Well, is that the scene?
That's the scene we're going to show. Yeah. I don't think we have to now because you just acted it out for us.
He was so villainous in this
terrifying
movie.
Terrifying.
Yeah.
It was one of the few moments in cinema where I've literally cheered a moment. I was so...
When they pitch him off the roof.
It was such a cathartic moment that happens in that film.
Remember when he fucking... Just when he's outside of his house, he's like, nice house. I said, nice house.
Mm-hmm.
Man should protect his family. Oh, this guy's terrifying. Well, now he's passed away.
Yeah.
But he was terrifying.
He was also in Clint Eastwood's Pale Rider. He did a ton of movies. Cutter's Way he was in. Worked in the Chuck Norris films. Did three Chuck Norris films. I don't know what he did to deserve that. But
He was on Charmed as well. He had a recurring role in Charmed as Barbas as well. Very talented actor. Always played bad guys because he had that weaselly face and that way about him, that greasy way about him. It was just always so terrifying, and you hated this guy. But he passed away at the age of 73, complications from a stroke. Here, as we say goodbye to Billy Drago, is that famous moment from The Untouchables.
Oh, yes. Yeah, bitch, justice. Oh, Batman without a cape, Elliot Ness.
How great was that moment?
That's so great.
He'll live forever.
Big bucket
of
wind, man. That was a fantastic villain role.
All right.
Is that it? The only dead people?
Sorry, yeah. We only lost two this week.
That's good. Thank God.
We like to take a look at movies as well and find out the things that go wrong in them, the mistakes, the gaffes, the things that someone should have caught before it reaches the audience, but they don't because they hate us secretly. They love our money, but they hate us. No, I'm kidding. We call this stuff shit that should not be.
And now for shit we should not see. Here's some shit that should not be.
This week's shit that should not be comes from Carissa. No, I'm good, thanks. I had my trauma already today. I don't need any more, thanks. This comes from Carissa. She was watching a movie on Netflix called Gifted, starring Captain America himself, Chris Evans. Do you remember this film?
No.
This is when Chris did a couple small films to try to stop, get away from the Captain America character a little bit.
What was The Gift?
The Gifted. No, it refers to his little niece. His sister dies and leaves his little niece in his care. And she is a gifted child. And she is really smart beyond her years. And he promised his sister that the kid would have a normal upbringing, but the mother wants the kid in a gifted program. Mm. So they battle over the rights of who gets to raise the kid.
And he battles the Red Skull?
No. No, in this, Chris Evans is just your ordinary, dreamy guy who runs a boat. He's got a boat, and he's the one women love in movies. He's ruggedly handsome, but deeply sensitive, good with his hands, can work on an engine and make a boat run. At least that's what we're told to believe. If you look at this scene from Gifted that Carissa sent us, you'll see him being dreamy and working on his boat. But is he really? Let's find out.
For the record, I didn't want to go to this stupid school in the first place.
There he is, working on that engine.
I'm getting the next row accident.
Working hard with that screwdriver.
Child.
Yeah.
Sorry, I'm still passive aggressive.
Yeah, what's he working on there? Oh.
No. Oh, no!
You didn't get in trouble for answering questions.
Yeah.
You yelled at the principal.
Let's punch in a little bit and see exactly what he's fixing there on that outboard motor.
Oh,
look at it.
In the first place.
Yeah, there's a big plastic cover on top. And
someone who's a child.
I'm sorry, I'm still passive aggressive.
He's just scraping the top of that engine with a screwdriver.
Oh, my Lord.
Just scraping the outer shell of an engine with a screwdriver.
Just putting the screwdriver
just
twisted
putting his
into
hand,
his hand.
This is me, I'm working. That's what I did when I was fucking five. I'm just like daddy, I'm building something.
Avengers assemble, because I can't assemble it. I
can't assemble an outboard, we know that much. Here's a bonus shit that should not be, by the way, because it was in the news. This happened this week and made me laugh so
hard.
Oh,
yeah, this was
They were putting posters out for the upcoming Spider-Man Far From Home movie. And they put two posters side by side that made Sam Jackson lose his shit. I don't know if you saw this on social media or not. Here it is. What in the actual fuck is going on here? Head's gonna roll left eye, motherfucker. Can we go to the next slide? You can see what he's angry about. Yeah, they can't decide where the patch goes on poor Nick Fury in that film. No wonder he was so upset. A representative for Sony did not comment.
I wonder why. They're hiding from Samuel Jackson. That's why.
I'm going to go see Spider-Man at 10 o'clock tomorrow morning for a private screening. Do you want to go?
You son of a bitch. No, I got a thing in the morning, sadly. I have to go to Peter's arraignment. I have to testify or they're going to let him out. Bring Steve.
Bring Steve.
We also love to take a look at acting. You know, A-list actors, big-name actors, don't always give great performances, and we have found that sometimes bad acting goes all the way around to become exquisite acting.
To be or not to be, that is the question.
Welcome to the world of exquisite acting with Ralph Garman and Kevin Smith.
This week's exquisite acting comes from Adam Trudeau in Detroit, Michigan. He calls this particular kind of acting shacting, because it's William Shatner.
Shacting.
It's from an episode of a TV series that was wildly popular in the 60s called The Fugitive with David Janssen. And he's a guest star in this episode from 1965, and it's a death scene. Thank you, Jesus. You get to watch William Shatner get shot and die about 42 minutes after the bullet enters his body. It's fucking brilliant. It is exquisite acting. Here's some shacting.
Yes, Tony is finally.
That's some shacting right wow. there, boys and girls. That's why he's the champion. Oh, boy.
I think, like, do you think he's ever saw anybody really die?
I can't imagine from that performance, no. Or just be shot in general.
Because it's so weird. Like, we spend most of our lives, like, seeing people die in movies and TV. And it is, there's always, like, this long enough beat to look betrayed. Like, how could you? I'm going to die. And then all the emotions going across the face. Yeah. Don't you think you're going to be really disappointed when you go to die and you don't have 15 seconds? You're going to be like...
I would have been freaked out if Peter, after I shot him, went... I'd be like, fuck, it's just like Shatner. He was right.
How could you do this, Mike?
You're not Mike.
Would have been his last words.
We'd love to take a look at all the entertainment news for the week as well in a segment we call the HBO Headlines. We were just talking about this song, Crazy Train, from Ozzy Osbourne. Apparently, the president, Donald Trump, used that this week in a Twitter post about the 2020 Democratic candidate debates. He put an image of that and then put Crazy Train underneath it.
Do you remember when Obama used to sit around and make fun of the Republican debates?
I do. Remember when? Oh, no. I don't remember that at all. No, yeah. Anyway, the Osbournes, Sharon and Ozzy, released a statement, like so many other musical artists have, saying, please don't use our music for your campaign. It's not okay. They're forbidding Trump and any campaign from using any Osbourne music in any political ads or political campaigns. Ozzy's music cannot be used for any means without his approvals. But then they went the extra step and they said, perhaps the president could reach out to some of his musician friends, and they named some names and suggested songs. Maybe he could use Kanye West's Gold Digger, they said.
Oh, shit.
Kid Rock's I Am the Bull God. Or Ted Nugent's Stranglehold. Maybe he could use those for music in the future.
A little bit of shade there.
So we'll wait and see. Yeah. More political show business news. This is when it crosses lines. Kevin Sorbo, who is a right-wing guy, and he's very vocal online. He was very out front talking about how people were criticizing White House Press Secretary, soon-to-be-departed, Sarah Sanders.
Yes.
Saying, where are all the feminists now speaking out on her behalf, and why are they all attacking her? And there was an actress named Haley Webb who starred with Kevin Sorbo in a movie from 2015 called Single in South Beach. I think that was a good one. I'm guessing that was a good one. Here's a picture of the two of them. There's Kevin on the left, and there's Haley Webb on the right. She released a tweet saying that perhaps he shouldn't comment on women's issues when he propositioned her on the set, and when she turned him down, he went to the producers and demanded sex scenes between their characters after she rebuffed his advances. That's a bad scene.
That's very
bad. Yeah, here's what she wrote. I don't think the person who repeatedly tried to pressure his 3 decades younger co-star into sleeping with him, publicly shame her on set when she refused to, and insist the director and add unnecessary sex scenes between us should be flapping his gums about feminism, she said.
Whoa.
How do we feel about Kevin Sorbo, Josh?
Disappointed!
Yes, exactly. We all knew that was coming. Remakes, reboots, refreshings, new creative versions. Do we need
them? We like them very
right.
much.
Yes, yes.
Nothing wrong with them.
No. Sometimes we love them, but most of the time we say, no thanks, we already got one.
No thanks, we've already got one. We don't need another one. It's already been done.
Maybe something good is going to come from Disney owning the world. You know, slowly but surely, they are buying up the world. And now they own Fox. And Fox had planned to do a remake, reboot, / reimagination of Alien Nation. Remember that movie with James Caan?
Yeah, yeah.
And Mandy Patinkin?
Where they the aliens drank milk, spoiled milk, to get drunk.
That's right.
And they made a TV show about it.
They did. It was a short-lived series as well. It was about a human cop who has a partner who's an alien because a bunch of them crash land on our planet, and they're sort of, it was an allegory for minorities, basically. And they team up, and it's a buddy cop movie between an alien and a human. And they said, this needs to be redone. And Disney, since they bought Fox, said, not so much. And they have taken that off the slate. They're no longer going to be making that film.
Oh.
Because Disney likes to make money. And given the current state of some reboots and sequels going on in the box office, maybe they're a little reticent to perhaps go forward with this project.
And they also have like so much now, like, you know.
And we've seen the alien human team up several times.
Like this, it sounds, this one first, of course, don't forget, but like Bright stole formula
Same premise,
Netflix movie.
Yeah, so I think we're good. However, some slip through the cracks, and this week it turns out, where's Jimmy V? Is he here tonight, Jimmy? You around? Hey, Jimmy, how are you, sir? He gave me the heads up on this one. This one slipped past me. I'm thankful that you pointed it out to me. The Charlie's Angels trailer dropped this week for the reboot of Charlie's Angels.
It did.
Elizabeth Banks not only stars as Bosley in the film, but is also directing the film. I'm so glad she got a job because it's just, she's been out of work for 12 minutes now, I think. Charlie's Angels rebooted with the grumpy girl from Twilight. And
she's not grumpy.
Oh, come on.
She's not. She's shy.
Is she?
Yeah, I interviewed her. She's a real good kid.
Comes
she's
off as
shy.
Grumpy. Someone should tell her. Maybe you should have in your interview. You should have said, do people think you're grumpy?
No.
You should have done a Jiminy Glick. Do people think you're grumpy?
No.
Why don't you ever smile?
I think she's a good kid. She's
Thank you. Well,
that was
a
pretty good Jiminy Glick.
Thank you so much. Anyway, the trailer came out, and let's just watch a piece of it. Let's just do that.
Let's get the weapon before it becomes every bad guy's favorite new toy. Take her to the closet, gear her up. We're gonna need some wigs, toys,
feisty
clothes. Ah, we're still in the first closet. There's another closet.
Oh my god.
Oh, Vince.
Let's just stop the touching. Some of these blows up.
See, Kevin, because there's a lot of clothes, but some of the accessories are weapons.
Who is Kristen Stewart's one of the girls?
Yes.
Is the other girl the girl from Aladdin? Naomi Scott.
Naomi Scott, yes.
And then who is the third angel?
Oh, her name is Brenda. I don't give a fuck.
I don't know. I'll go. I'm a sucker for that.
Stop it.
I mean, I like Charlie's Angels since I was a kid.
Me too.
I love the McGee movies.
Me too.
Unapologetically. I love them both.
We're good then.
So maybe
I say, no thanks. We already got 7. And they tried a series again, and that didn't go. And I think
did they try a series?
They did. They did, Kevin Smith.
I know me. I'll give it a shot.
Leonardo DiCaprio's in the news. Let's face it, Leonardo DiCaprio wins. He's got everything. He is one of the best actors of his generation. He is rich beyond avarice. He's handsome. All he has sex with is supermodels. Sometimes like a fistful of them at a time. He's got everything going on. There was a photo of him this week. And the reason I show this photo is because he makes me feel bad. He makes me sad because he's got so much and the rest of us have so little. And he was with what he calls his boo crew, all his friends in Malibu that he hangs out with. And that name, boo crew. They play beach volleyball a lot with supermodels. That's what they do. Here's a shot of Leo on the beach with his boo crew playing beach volleyball with supermodels. And the only reason I bring it up is because this next picture made me feel better about myself. Can we show the next thing that happened to Leo? Bam! He missed a spike and got nailed square in the face this week. And it's a little respite. It's a little respite for me to say he doesn't have everything all the time. He's just like us, Kevin. That's what I'm trying to say. It's like Us Magazine. Celebrities are just like us.
Exactly. I was supposed to interview...
Play volleyball with
I was going to go hang out with the boo crew.
The boo crew?
No, I was supposed to interview him and Margot Robbie and Robbie. Margot, how do you pronounce it?
Robbie.
Yeah. Quentin and Brad Pitt for the...
Oh, is that all? Time. Just those four?
But
was the Dalai Lama not available?
But I can't do it because I'm committed to something else in Vegas for that evening. So we were trying to do it in the morning, and they can't do the interviews until the afternoon, so I missed my opportunity. But the nice thing was they all requested me.
Oh,
and
that's
I was kinda
nice.
Sweet. And I was like, sorry, gotta let you down. Like, fuck you, Silent Bill.
Good for you, man. Don't let them tell you what to do.
I really wanted to sit
Fuck
down
those beautiful
Quentin,
people
though.
Who
that
are rich.
Been fucking amazing. Just
talented.
To chat about the movie.
I know. It would have been great, but I'm glad you rejected them. I hope you rejected them. Send them a bouquet of black roses.
No, not at all. I just couldn't make it. I really wanted to sit down with him. I was been like, thank you for casting my fucking kid in the movie.
Right.
Jesus, man. Because life would have sucked if that didn't happen, man. She's trying out.
Would have been the one that got away.
Oh, God. Well, it did get away. She didn't get the part. And then for like 2 weeks, like it was just misery in the house. And then somebody called up going like, hey, she's supposed to be in here for a hair and makeup test. And
that's
wrong
confusing.
Information. Yeah, it got conveyed and suddenly she was fucking in.
Oh, maybe I'm still waiting on a call for my hair and makeup test too. And maybe I'm in the movie and I don't even know it. Speaking of casting news, Paul Rudd has just announced he's joining Ghostbusters 2020. Paul Rudd to be in every movie that they make all the time.
He's also a good guy.
I find him endlessly charming and enjoyable and believable and lovely, and I just love everything he does.
I think this Ghostbusters movie is going to be good, man.
I think so too, right?
Yeah.
They got Carrie Coon already, who's playing the mom, and apparently the premise from what we know of it is a single mother who's raising a kid, and somehow the Ghostbusters are involved with that. But Carrie Coon from Fargo, if you saw that, she was amazing in that series. Finn
Wolfhard.
Deathheart, or whatever his
Wolfhard.
Name is. Wolfhard.
Deathheart.
That'd be a cooler name. Finn
Deathheart.
It's a
Deathheart. Very metal name, Finn yes. Wolfhard.
He's playing the kid, apparently, and so Paul Rudd will play his teacher, McKenna Grace, who was in Gifted, by the way. He played the little girl in Gifted. She's also in the film. Now, I don't know what all these kids and people have to do with busting ghosts, but I'm willing to find out.
We're going to find out. You saw the teaser, though, right?
Yeah, it looks awesome.
It was like a old barn or a farmhouse
or
something like that.
Yeah, and they take the Ecto for a spin. More casting news. Henry Cavill has been tapped to play Sherlock Holmes in a new movie.
That kind of makes sense.
Yeah, finally he can play somebody who's British.
Yeah, really.
Play one of their fucking heroes for a change, why don't you?
It's been a minute.
Stop stealing ours.
First time I saw him was in The Tudors. He was like Henry's best friend.
He was so good in that.
But it's been a minute since he was British.
Yeah. He is playing Sherlock Holmes in a movie called Enola Holmes, which is a very popular young girl's book series about the younger daughter, younger sister of Sherlock and Mycroft Holmes.
Oh.
And she's a detective in her own right, a la Nancy Drew kind of thing. So he'll be playing her big brother, Sherlock. We got a shot of the girl from Stranger Things is playing Enola.
Oh, it's Millie Bobby Brown, is
yeah.
that her name?
And,
that's cool.
And so he's playing Sherlock Holmes, and he's going to be dreamy. That's because he always is. This is my favorite video.
I wonder if he'll have a mustache this time around.
They're going to make him grow a mustache just so they can
Take
digitally
it
remove it. Yes, just to be consistent. This is my favorite video of the week by far. There is a company called, it's not a company, it's a consortium, actually. It's a group of people. It's car companies and advocacy groups and utility companies and government agencies. It's called Velaz, and they're trying to get people to switch over from gas-burning cars to electric cars. They're trying to get people's heads around the idea that it can be just as fun to drive an electric car as it is a gas guzzler. And so they put a video out this week as part of their promotional campaign, and part of the video was to have Arnold Schwarzenegger dress up as a car salesman and try to prank people by telling them that they don't want to buy electric cars, they should buy gas-burning cars instead. So he's like a really rude, obnoxious wonk for the oil companies. Now, here's the thing. You can't disguise Arnold Schwarzenegger. With the voice and the look and the body and everything, the best you can do is have fun with it. And that's what they did. The video dropped this week. It's called Kicking Gas. And it's Schwarzenegger trying to convince people who really are trying to do the right thing for the environment and buy electric cars and sway them back to gas burners.
Yeah, actually, I'm looking for some kind of electric hybrid mix.
But don't bullsh** me.
Okay.
I'm just tired of spending money at the pump.
Yeah. The pump?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, this is great. You go to the gas station, you pump. Let me tell you something. The pump sometimes is more satisfying than sex.
I'd like to use something that can get me into the carpool lane, actually.
Oh, you mean a sticker? This is your lucky day. Anyone that buys a car today gets a free bumper sticker.
I'll be back.
Here, carpool lanes are for sissies. I support the oil company monopoly. You can choose any of those. Can a battery-powered power car do this?
No, no, no. I think this will piss off my neighbor.
You them right, it will impress your neighbors. This is their star strong.
He's good now. That may be his best role ever. He's very funny in that.
This is funny. This is the best, funniest movie since Twins.
Exactly, yes. And lastly, every once in a while, we got to check in with our neighbor from the north. He's awful. He's Justin Bieber. You know him.
Justin Bieber. Nobody fucking needs ya. You wanna know why? I'll tell you why. 'Cause you're a little cunt.
Yeah, yeah, he is. We didn't get a chance to talk about this Tom Cruise Justin Bieber fight.
It's kind of nutty. I thought the last thing I heard, though, he called him out to a fight, and then he was like, I'm kidding.
No, but now Dana White, the president of the UFC, has gone on record this week saying initially it was a joke, but now he's been talking to several people in both camps, and they're trying to actually make it happen. Here's what he said. I don't use any names, but I was at home on Sunday, and I got a call from two big guys on the phone. They were telling me this could possibly happen. This could be real.
Wow.
If it does, call me back. I'm in. He said, it would be massive. Everybody laughed when we talked about this, so you've heard of it. But who wouldn't watch that? Everybody would watch it. It's a complete train wreck. I love it. I'm in, he said. I want it to happen.
Yeah.
So badly.
Who do you think wins? Cruz, right?
I think Cruz, because it's Jesus versus L. Ron Hubbard.
I thought about that.
Who's in whose corner? You know, I don't know, L. Ron.
Christians versus Scientologists.
Just saying, that's the battle right there.
That's true, man.
It reminds me of that old show on MTV, Deathmatch. Remember the Claymation
Celebrity
series?
Celebrity Deathmatch.
Yeah, it's like a gag out of that.
Oh, my God, it is. Celebrity Deathmatch come to life.
More Bieber news. His wife had a bad week. Haley Baldwin Bieber had a bad week.
What happened?
She tried to trademark her new brand for cosmetic products called Bieber Beauty. And she...
Oh, because that's her last name now.
Bieber's her last name, yeah. So she's trying to release Bieber Beauty. She went to the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office to put in her trademark for Bieber Beauty.
And
it got bounced back. It got rejected. It got blocked.
And Bieber Beauty was bounced back and blocked?
She was very sad. Turns out the person who had blocked it was her husband.
Why?
Justin already has the trademark for his own group of cosmetics, fragrances, soaps, and shampoos. Called Bieber Beauty. And so since that had gotten in there first, hers was actually rejected. So her husband,
man, happy wife, happy life. He should give her the name Bieber Beauty.
Absolutely.
And he should take a new name for his company. I suggest Living Asshole.
Kevin and I are huge geeks, so we love to take a look at the geek news.
Ralph and Kevin, Ralph and Kevin, Ralph and Kev. Geek news.
This is sweet. I'm happy to see this. Stan Lee's first novel for adults is going to be released posthumously. His book is going to finally hit bookstores. He wrote it a while ago, along with a co-writer named Kat Rosenfield, and it's called A Trick of the Light. It's for adults, but it's not completely off-brand for Stan, because it is about a gifted young man struggling with newfound fame after a freak accident gives him the ability to manipulate technology with his mind. Mm. So he's, instead of Spider-Man, he's Computer Man, basically. Right. Yeah.
Spider-Man.
But apparently it's a much more adult take on a superhero origin story, and it's the beginning of what he hoped would be a new universe of adult books based on science fiction and superhero themes called Stan Lee's Alliances, and this is the first in the series. So it'll be out on September 17th, 2019, and he'll finally have, you know, he always said he wanted to write the great American novel when he started off, and so
he
now,
did. He just didn't realize it. He just did it with
true.
Spider-Man and the
he
Avengers.
He did more than the average person who writes the great American novel.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
We have a nice little tribute to him in our movie. In the movie itself, and then in the once the movie ends, when the credits start rolling, there's a big Stan thing, which is really sweet. Because he was supposed to be in it. So, bummer, sadly, he's not.
Speaking of comic books and comic characters, Taika Waititi, who, of course, we know from Thor Ragnarok.
What do we do in the shadows?
He is going to take a crack at bringing Flash Gordon back on.
Yes! Such a good idea.
Now, here's the thing. I loved that idea, and I wanted to see it, but sadly, they've decided to go with an animated feature instead of a live action.
Sony Animation?
Yeah.
Yes! They did Spider-Man into the Spider-Verse. So
I know. I'll
take it.
I'm hoping there's some bleed over from the guys who did that and the whole department over there that's all part of the
I'm
same
sure
family.
It is, especially Taika Waititi. I'm sure he'll make it look good. But think about it. It's almost redundant for him to do a live-action Flash Gordon. That's kind of what Thor Ragnarok was.
Yeah, I suppose.
So at least doing the animated thing, you could go in a new direction. And, you know, Flash Gordon did come from the newspaper strip. So
1934 is when it started in the comic strips. I didn't even know it was that old. It was as an answer to Buck Rogers, which came out in 1928.
My God, so Buck Rogers is older
characters.
Than Flash Gordon.
Yeah.
Were the stories that inspired George Lucas and Steven Spielberg.
Yeah, these are the OG spacemen. This has been in development for a couple years, this Flash Gordon reboot. Kingsman's Matthew Vaughn was supposed to take it on initially, and then he fell out of that project. Then Overlord director Julius Avery was supposed to. He fell out. So now it's fallen to Taika. So I'm hoping that it comes true, because
I
think he's got
it.
Such a great sense of humor and a great sensibility.
He
I think
does,
it'd be fun.
And that Sony Animation's on a real roll.
And lastly, it's so awesome. Has anyone been to Star Wars Galaxy's Edge down there in Disneyland? Has anybody seen it? That many of you?
It's a good portion, man.
I'm surprised.
Why?
Because I think the line to get in is 4 days.
Yeah. You got to make the jump to light speed.
You have
there,
to
man.
Do. It's so funny because the whole premise of the ride, Smuggler's Run on the Millennium Falcon, and sort of the general area, is it's all about smugglers and contraband and that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Disney has their own problem with smugglers and contraband right now online. People are stealing stuff from Galaxy's Edge and putting it up online as souvenirs.
You know what? I don't doubt that. Even if you went and you got a napkin that said Galaxy's Edge on it, you could put it up and somebody will buy it.
That's what's happening. At the cantina, a coaster that you take from the bar or the cantina is going for $10 at least on eBay right now, some for more. They give you a card while you're waiting in virtual queue for the cantina because there's only so much room, so they kind of give you a wait list card.
Right.
Those are being auctioned off on eBay. But the real problem Disney has is the menus at the cantina, which are supposed to stay there after you order.
People are tagging them.
Under the old jacket and out the door, they're going from $40 to $200 on eBay for a menu.
Oh, my God.
From the cantina.
All you need is one and a photocopier machine. And you got yourself a small fortune.
Here's a shot of what they look like.
Oh, my God. Let's just make a couple copies
let's
of that.
Go print those. Yeah, it's got the Star Wars language on there as well as other stuff. But it's the only place in Disneyland now where you can drink booze. So I love it, of course, as you can imagine.
You haven't gone yet, have you?
No, I haven't.
Yeah, man, that's fucking nuts. Like, think about it. Who's that hurting? Like that $10 coaster somebody puts up online, the person that liked that coaster, like they'll happily spend $10 for him and
right.
shit. Like, I don't know. I don't see a crime here.
And it's good publicity, right? It's people spreading the word.
And also, like, you know, if I was Star Wars and Disney, I wouldn't be mad to be associated with, like, you can make a little scratch off this Disney. Because, look, they make a lot of scratch off us and shit. So
agreed.
If you can fucking sell a coaster from Star Wars.
However, word has it that Disney employees who work at the cantina are being told to take the menus back more quickly after people order their food and drinks.
Are they really?
Yes.
I heard one guy took it so seriously, whipped out a lightsaber and cut a fucker's arm off and shit.
My friend doesn't like you. I don't like you either.
All right. Before we go home, we got one more last bit of business to do.
Still time? Oh, my God.
Yeah, it's time to go.
Who knew?
It's time for us to take a look inside the pants of one of our favorite actors, Mr. Liam Neeson. Apparently, he's got a really big cock.
Oh, we can't help but wonder, how big is Liam Neeson's cock?
Wie groß ist Liam Neeson's penis?
That's right. Some people are going along with it like they know what it says. I heard everybody's like, Neeson's penis. Trying to sing along.
Borky, bork. Say it again. This is how it begins.
Yes.
In a beer hall.
Deutschland, Deutschland, über alles.
What is, do you know that language?
No.
Con man.
I graduated high school in Germany. I'm a little bit of German.
You are German.
Jawohl. Wait, so you graduated high school in Germany, but you didn't, you're not German.
No, I'm not.
Okay.
In the army, we were stationed in Germany.
Oh, like an army brat kind of thing.
Correct.
Got you. We can hear you, you know. It's just, we're not the Rose Bowl, for fuck's sake. It's just, we're right here.
They taught you to project over in Germany.
Yes.
Say it loud and proud. We have nothing to be ashamed of.
My father was later transferred to another base.
And now tonight's top story.
Classic.
Translated for the hard of hearing.
General Francisco Franco is still dead.
Yeah, we're old, but it's
you
fun,
are
right?
Old, but, yeah.
You guys are kind enough to send us facts about Liam Neeson's cock each and every week, and damn it, we're still going to talk about him. Why not? This came from Todd Sellers, by the way. I thought he put a lot of work into this, so usually I don't say the names, but I appreciated the effort. Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
It's on Snapchat. Here we go.
Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
How big is it? It's so big that it's on Snapchat.
It was a wiener. It was a talking wiener.
I think I got that part.
Oh, all right. Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
He doesn't use lube. He uses pine tar. It's a baseball
reference.
Baseball
thing.
Yeah. It's baseball season. Liam Neeson's cock is so big. The Sci-Fi Channel is rebooting a docu-series about a case of crabs he caught in the 1980s. We've got a picture, we got a screen grab from the show. That's some of them, real life size, by the way. Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
Liam lost a leg 20 years ago and no one has noticed. Keeps listing to one side, that's all. Just leaning on him. And lastly, Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
He doesn't masturbate. He throws it over his shoulder and he burps it.
Ladies and gentlemen of Hollywood, have you had a good time this evening?
So good to be home. Thanks for being here. We can't do it without you guys.
I can't thank you enough for being here, but give it up for the guy without whom there is no Babylon, Mr. Ralph fucking Garman.
Let's hear it from my buddy and Babel brother, Mr. Kevin Smith.
And that is Hollywood Babylon for this week. I'm Kevin Smith.
I'm Ralph Garman.
Babel of Argon. Good night, Hollywood.
Give it.
Norman and Kevin Smith.